Thank you. So we're going to take the next 15 minutes or so and talk through IBM, help you build an OpenStack cluster at scale, and help you then add some governance to it. So since we only have 15 minutes, I'll get right into it. If you've been listening to IBM lately, you've probably heard us talk about three things. At the top level, there's the IBM Cloud Marketplace, recently announced at IBM Impact, that allows you to go find a full suite of software as a service solutions. As you move down the stack, you'll see codenamed Bluemix. This is our Cloud Foundry-based PaaS. What I'm going to talk about today is at the very bottom, the infrastructure as a service level, OpenStack, and Softlayer, and how you can use Softlayer to get started with OpenStack. If you're not familiar with OpenStack or Softlayer, it's a broad portfolio of infrastructure that you can choose, right? Do you want bare metal, virtual servers, dedicated or shared, physical or virtual, or hourly or monthly? You can go to their portal and get that. If you want some bare metal machines, 2 to 4 hours, you can get them delivered. This is important because Softlayer has a global cloud platform. They're going to have 25 data centers at the end of the year spread across the world. And it's the ideal platform to build scalable, available, reliable OpenStack clouds. But not only can you build them there, I'll talk a little bit about how you can help get started with OpenStack very easily at Softlayer. No commitments. Go out, get started, build your first install. And that's what we'll walk through. But why would you want to deploy OpenStack on Softlayer? You can acquire the hardware you need when you need it. You can scale it in hours, not days, not weeks. You can add more bare metal in no time. Have an immediate global presence. Like I said, there's going to be 25 data centers around the world at the end of this year, 40 if you count all of the IBM cloud data centers. There's low latency, high speed connectivity between all those data centers. They have a dedicated fiber network that connect all of their data centers together. There are no transfer charges. If you build an OpenStack cluster at Softlayer, you do it on the private network, there are no transfer charges from any data center to another. If you take an interconnect into their network, their private network, there's no transfer fees from on-premise. And you can choose the OpenStack model that works for you. Do you want to bring your own OpenStack? Do you want to get it from us? Do you want to manage? Do you want us to manage? With Softlayer and IBM, you have those choices. From a hardware perspective, the hardware that Softlayer has, you can go from entry level single procs all the way up to GPUs and quad cores, or quad processor, fully customizable RAM, hard drives, SSDs, network. Do you want 1 gig, 10 gig? And on demand, bare metal servers in 2 to 4 hours. So this is interesting, but how do I actually get an OpenStack cloud, build it, and scale it globally? So here's what I did. I went to the OpenStack manuals, pulled up the installation guide for Ubuntu 12. I did this on Friday night. I went to the example architecture, and they gave me this diagram for OpenStack networking with Neutron install. So this is what I was going to replicate. In the Before You Begin section, it listed out exactly what I need. A controller node, a network node, and a compute node. So easy enough. I went out to Softlayer's website, went to the server section, chose bare metal servers. Actually, I started with the virtual servers. For my controller node, I got exactly what it asked for. 1 core, 2 gigs of RAM, 25 gig hard drive, 6 cents an hour. For the network node, I got 1 core, 1 gig, 25 gigs of hard drive, 4 cents an hour. And for the compute node, I got bare metal, a 2 core, 2 gig machine, which met the minimum, for 24 cents an hour. So I had 34 cents an hour in my install, or 8 hours a day to get this set up and get started with OpenStack. But those specs aren't really useful. You can't really do anything with it. Maybe start up a few CIROS images. So let's get something usable. I went back, got a little stronger controller node and network node, put 1 gig uplink ports on it, 100 gigs of disk, a little more RAM, came out to 17 cents an hour. For the compute node, 16 gigs of RAM, 4 cores, again, a 1 gigabyte network, 53 cents an hour. So now I'm up to 70 cents an hour, about 16 cents a day to get started with OpenStack. So I went through this. I didn't talk about one thing, which is the network connectivity. all Softlayer systems come with three networks: a public network that is metered, a private network that is unmetered, and a management network for out-of-band management. In our case, if you looked back at that reference architecture, there were three networks that they connect to. And understanding this helps understand how to map that. So when I look at this, there's the management network, hypervisor to hypervisor communication, and the instance tunnels, which are guest to guest. Those are easy. They map right to the Softlayer private network for all that connectivity. Again, unmetered, no charges. But what about that external, right? How do I get outside of the guest? That was the piece that I needed to add. Went back to the Softlayer portal, got what's called a portable private subnet. In this case, I used an internal one, portable private, accessible only in Softlayer. Again, no charge for those. So that's it. I've got all the resources I need to build an OpenStack cloud at Softlayer at 70 cents an hour. So going back to the install guide, I went back and stepped through all of it. I actually did this in two regions. I first started in San Jose. I had the two virtual machines, three physical machines for the cloud I built. That took about 90 minutes to get all the hardware up and running. I didn't do anything. I clicked it, actually left, came back in 90 minutes. It was all ready to go. Copied and pasted from the OpenStack documentation, just following step by step. Took me about 4 hours of copying and pasting, just mindless work. Ran into problems with Neutron. I spent about 3 hours before I figured out that I really just needed to restart like the DHCP agent and it started working. So then I did it again. I went and got hardware in Singapore. Again, waited about 90 minutes for my bare metal to come up. Copied and pasted from the OpenStack documentation. I only had one machine I needed to copy and paste to instead of three compute nodes. Went a little bit faster. About 2 hours worth of work there. I had an outside, again, something happened with Neutron. I spent about 6 hours before someone pointed out I just needed to restart my L3 agent, and then it worked. So if you ignore all the Neutron time I spent, I had about 9 hours in this. When I was done, I had Horizon running, multi-region install, one in Singapore, one in San Jose. Took me, I said, about 9 hours, and everything was fully functional. I could SSH into my guest from external. I had Neutron running with GRE tunnels. Everything, it was a pretty typical OpenStack install and a very easy way to get started. I will be putting out a blog post on how I did this in the next couple days, probably early next week, so that you can try and replicate it. But yes, it was very easy and something that I would, you know, if you want to get started, it's the way to do it. And this was my dashboard running. You can see my two regions, region one and Singapore. I didn't realize with region one that I should have named it San Jose from the start. But one thing that, when you look at this, one of the hard parts is that you can't really turn people loose on the Horizon UI in an enterprise, right? You need approvals and expiration policies. And Nina from our IBM Cloud Manager with OpenStack team is going to talk a little bit about how you can use IBM Cloud Manager with this with OpenStack to add these features. There you go.
We've lost it.
What happened to
the display?
So, can you see me?
All right, thank you. Okay. All right, so thanks, Mike. So as Michael said, we have the Cloud Manager with OpenStack, which provides some additional layers of governance over OpenStack. So this is a self-service portal that you see. We've signed on as a cloud administrator, and you can see all the features and functions that the capabilities that are available to the cloud administrator. You have some standard things that all OpenStack users would expect. You have the ability to configure the cloud, where you define which regions you want to monitor. The ability to create your projects, manage users and roles, again, standard Keystone stuff. But apart from that, if you look at the right-hand side of the screen, it shows you the cloud status. So here you have a single pane of glass which allows you to monitor and manage multiple regions at one shot, where you don't have to, you know, work with one and toggle between them. As you can see, we have two regions, as Michael had. He had his in Singapore and San Jose. Through the Cloud Manager, you can manage all those regions, and if you look at the capacity utilization, it'll actually show you the nodes you have in each of the regions. And in this case, we have two regions. You know, you've got your KVM nodes that Michael talked about. And Cloud Manager with OpenStack actually supports different architectures. We support hypervisors, x86, we support KVM, Hyper-V, as Michael said. But we also support Power. We support Power VM, Power KVM, as well as EVM. So you have the different filter options. Michael had talked about three nodes that he'd set up in his region. But the big thing we're talking about is governance. And what we do is we allow you to apply governance policies at a project level. So we have two kinds of policies, approvals that Michael talked about, but we also have expiration policies. This is a DevOps environment, if you look at the kind of projects I have. So at the development project, you know, most of us do agile development, we follow 2-week sprints. So we've set up an expiration policy so that as our users, at the end of 2 weeks of their VM being deployed, we stop the VM. We give them a 3-day grace period if they have any defects, bug fixes they're working on. And at the end of the additional 3 days, we actually delete the VM. We free up the resources. The development team's on to the next sprint, you know, fire up a new set of VMs and continue their work. So that's extremely convenient. The next thing I'd like to show you is really how easy it is to work these policies into when you're actually deploying your VMs. So at this point, I've switched over to a test project. And since this is a demo, I've just used Syros because it goes really quickly. At the point of deploying, do you see the expiration date has already been set? This is based on the policy that the cloud administrator had set up against that project. And that's it. You just go ahead, create the VM. This tester needs 5 VMs for their test environment. So instead of submitting 5 requests, at the point of your deploy request, you could just, you know, say how many VMs you want us to fire up, and that's it. We have gone ahead and done the deploy. Again, as everything else here is a single pane of glass, if you wanted to, you could look at all your VMs across all your clouds. In this case, we're working with the Eastern region, so just filtered on Eastern. And you can see we have 5 VMs already deployed through the development team. This request was for 5 additional VMs from the test team. You can see the deployment has started. And at this point, I'd like to switch over to the OpenStack dashboard. Because when you do your deployments, by default, you know, one tends to use the default Nova scheduler. But IBM with the IBM Cloud Manager with OpenStack, we actually ship our own scheduler. We have something called the Platform Resource Scheduler, which has quite sophisticated policies that you can apply. So I was just going to quickly show you that. It's an extension to Horizon, so you see it in your dashboard. And we have 2 sets of policies. We have the initial placement policy, which is what takes effect when you do your deployment request. You have different kinds of policies that you could specify. We've gone with striping, which is where you want to evenly distribute your workload across your different nodes. But as you can see, you have different kinds of policies. And then we have the concept of your runtime policy, which is once your deployment is done, things can change in your environment. You know, your VMs could be deleted. And so your runtime policy monitors the nodes and dynamically adjusts where your VMs reside based on these policies. Now, as you can see, if you go back and check against your hypervisors, we had 3 nodes. We had the striping policy in place. We had our 5 development VMs, and then we had our 5 additional instances for testing. You can see it was evenly distributed, and all this was transparent to the application. Right? So I just wanted to show you we've got the management policies for expiration and deployment, and then we've got your resource scheduler, which is really how you would optimize where you distribute your workloads. Thank you.
All right, thank you. If you have any questions, we'll be here for a couple minutes. You can also stop by the IBM booth. So thank you.